Moving on, Kevin Paulo is going to give us a very brief introduction to a project that he's been working on. He's also talking tomorrow at another mini-conf, which he'll tell you about if you want to hear more detail.
Thank you. So I'll give you today a very quick overview of a project that I've been working on called Sizzix. It was good to hear B-Dale's keynote this morning about scratching your own itch, because for me, that's a very large part of this project. Okay, so traditionally when you install a package on a system, it tends to splat its files all over the place. So you'll get binary programs that you can run going in /bin, libraries in /lib, and so on. Sizzix does not do this. One of the downsides to having to a traditional sort of package management system is that for any given package, you can only have a single version of that installed at any given time, precisely because everything's going into these common areas like user bin. So Sizzix does not do this. In Sizzix, by contrast, everything gets installed into its own location. And so by default, that's a path which starts with /sw, which stands for software. Then there's a spot for repo, so it's a sort of a broad package collection. And then there's architecture, so x86, 64, Linux or something. Finally followed by a directory for the actual package and a directory for each version. So what this does let you do is have multiple versions of packages installed cleanly on your system at any point in time, which I think is a very good thing. This has been done before in the past by a variety of systems. So one of the oldest is GNU Stow, which some of you will know about. In Python land, there's a thing called virtualenv, which is about managing versions of Python installations and the associated Python modules. Ruby has a similar thing called RVM, Ruby Version Manager, along the same sorts of lines. There's a newer one called OSTree, which is primarily used by the GNOME people, and it's about managing multiple entire operating system trees and being able to switch between them, which is similar but different. And then there's a full distribution called Gobo Linux, which is based around this idea and others, and another one called NixOS. Out of curiosity, who in the audience has heard about NixOS? Yeah, that's what I thought. So Nix is a package manager which is purely functional, which basically means that there are no side effects, and the net result is a very similar situation where you have multiple versions of packages installed cleanly and separately, the dependencies between them tracked, and ways of dealing with it. But one thing that all of these systems have in common that they tend to rely on is symlinks. And lots and lots and lots of symlinks. Sizzix does not like symlinks, not at least as a primary way of working. Instead, Sizzix likes to use the path and the related variables, like ld library path for libraries, cpath for finding c include libraries, and so on. So what this means is that not only do you have the ability to have multiple versions of any given package installed on the system at any point in time, but now by using the process environment, you can dynamically switch between those. And you can do that on a per process and a per user basis. Whereas with symlinks, they tend to be on a per system basis that you can fiddle with the symlinks, and it will affect everyone on the system or all of the processes on the system at the time. And I think this is a very good thing. Sizzix is built on a piece of software called, mainly built on it, called environment modules, which have been around for a long time, over 20 years. But environment modules, or modules for short, have mainly found use in large high-performance computing and supercomputer sites over the years, and not really got much traction elsewhere. So this is an example of how you go about using the Sizz utility, which is the main part of Sizzix. So you can ask it what Sizz files are loaded, and you can see here there's four of them. So can I point? I think I'll waste my time. So for the modules piece of software, it's a specific version called 3.2.6. But the other pieces of software are Devel. The version is Devel, which basically means they're Git clones, which makes doing development work a little bit easier. So if I wanted to use Python, well, it's not there by default. So I can ask what Python sys files are available, and I can see there's a version for 2.6.7, 2.7.3, a wrapper for 2.7.3, and also a version for Python 3 if I'm interested. So okay, I can go ahead and load one of those, and that then modifies the environment so that I now have access to that version of Python. This isn't rocket science, right? This is just fiddling with dollar path and stuff like that. If I now then go and see what's loaded in my environment by doing a syslist, you can see that the same four original ones are there. Python 2.6.7 is at the end of the list, but it's also dragged in all of the runtime dependencies for that Python package and the specific versions. So if I now decide, okay, maybe I want to try Python 2.7, instead I can just do a sys swap, and that will basically unload the 2.6.7 version of Python and load up the 2.7.3. And so now I have that version of Python available to me.
What about dependencies?
So they're tracked. That's how it knows about the dependencies. I can't go into that today. I've got 10 minutes, but tomorrow, if you're interested. Yep, so if I unload Python, then it's gone. So the neat thing about this is that I can also do things like swapping out various of the dependencies. So I can swap those for different versions if I wanted to test how Python behaves with a different version of zlib, for example, or something like that. That's possible and basically trivial, actually. So now I'll quickly run through a few of the features and the benefits that having a setup like this can give you, and sort of my main reasons and drivers for trying to do this. So one of the nice things about this is that the whole idea of stable or unstable doesn't make much sense anymore. You can be stable and unstable, right? You can have a set of stable versions of packages installed on your system and using those as the default versions most of the time or all of the time. And then if you want to try out an unstable version of a package, that's fine, install it. It doesn't change anything except that that version is now also available. And you can sys-swap to it and try it out ahead of time or otherwise. So you can either install packages, make them the default, see what breaks, and if you don't like that, change the default back. And that's it. You can go the other way around instead and install a new version of a piece of software and not make it the default, and instead carefully test it out, try it, see if it works, and then when you're happy with it, make it the default. So it's also, SysX is primarily intended to be a sort of rolling release system where new versions of packages come along all the time, but you can still do standard releases where you sort of drop off a whole collection of packages at a known state. In fact, in SysX, this basically corresponds to a list of versions of packages which are known to work well together. You can do binary packages, which will probably end up being along the lines of simple tarballs like Slackware. But you still have the flexibility of doing source builds, and there's a utility for that. And in fact, like Gobo Linux, with the package manager being the file system, you can install stuff by hand if you want, and it's a first-class citizen and will work just fine. SysX's build system is highly parameterized by version. Most software, most of the time, the actual build process doesn't change from version to version. So you should just be able to hit build on the new version and get it. And there's two ways of it can either be installed standalone as a full distribution, except you can't yet, or hosted. So what this means is because everything lives under /sw, it's independent of whether you run CentOS or SUSE or whatever. And the target audience is multi-user systems, so large sites running single shared login systems, power users and developers. And if you're interested in more, this is where you come. Tomorrow at 10:40 a.m. at the start of the cross-distro mini-conf, which I think is in MCC5 last time I checked. And I'm happy to field questions then. Thank you very much.